In 2024, I managed to accomplish more than I ever expected. Working full-time as an oncology pharmacist at a busy cancer hospital, starting this YouTube channel, and consistently uploading at least 3 videos a month. What might surprise you is that I did all of this after quitting coffee. If it's your New Year's resolution to quit caffeine completely, or just cut back on the amount that you consume, or simply improve your productivity and energy levels, then keep watching this video. I'll be sharing with you the health reasons that motivated me to quit, both personal and backed by scientific data. I'll walk you through the simple step-by-step scientific method that helped me quit completely. And then at the end, I'll give you an honest answer of how I feel on a typical day without any caffeine. When I was in pharmacy school, I would stay up until 2 a.m. almost every day playing video games. You thought I was gonna say studying, weren't you? I mean, I just needed to win one more game before I go to sleep. Of course, I'd be super sleepy the next day, so I'll either skip class or just fall asleep in class. Not recommended. I somehow made it to graduation, got my license to practice, became a more mature and responsible person, and continued to game. So my habits stayed, but my age didn't. Year after year, as my body grew older, I was no longer able to function as well on minimal sleep the next day. And this is when I discovered coffee. I mean, don't get me wrong. I drank in sensible amounts. I survived on one cup of coffee in the morning. I sometimes make another tea for myself at the staff lounge in the hospital. But this is not counting the Coke Zero, other caffeinated soft drinks, and the boba, we actually call it bubble tea here in Canada, that I drink throughout the day, more often than I like to admit. You're probably expecting me to talk about all the negative side effects of caffeine at this point, but I'm actually going to talk about a very few interesting positives of caffeine that I don't think anyone expected until we ran really, really large studies to look at people who drink coffee every day. The one that interested me the most, a cancer pharmacist, is of course caffeine's relationship with cancer. And this gigantic multinational study published in the International Journal of Cancer looked at more than 30,000 cases of colorectal cancer and found that there's an inverse relationship between drinking coffee and all-cause mortality. And then this even larger study said, well, now that we know there's a link between drinking coffee and reduce the risk of death, we want to look at the difference between coffee sweetened with sugar, with artificial sweetener, and just plain black coffee. This one was even bigger and looked at 171,000 participants and followed them for 7 years. And their result was even more intriguing. They found a U-shaped relationship between drinking coffee and death. With black coffee, drinking 2.5 to 3.5 cups per day significantly reduced all-cause mortality. But drinking more than that, the graph goes back up closer to the baseline of drinking no coffee. With sweetened coffee with sugar, it's also a U-shape similar to black coffee. But when people drank more than 3.5 cups a day, it actually exceeds the death rate of drinking no coffee. The relationship between artificially sweetened coffee and death rate was inconsistent, so the study didn't draw any conclusion on that. And on top of that, there's an even larger study to show the protective effect of caffeine on depression. They looked at 346,000 participants, and they found another shape, a J shape, which means the incident drops, but then increases dramatically. They found a peak protective effect of caffeine against depression at 400 mL per day. That's about 1.5, just under 2 cups. I'll put all the names of the studies in my description box, so if you're interested to learn more, definitely give them a read. With all that being said though, I would definitely not start drinking coffee just because of these study results showing some preliminary benefits. I just wanted to share these results with you because I thought they were really interesting, and personally, even knowing all these benefits exist, I started noticing changes in my own body ever since my coffee consuming habits started. I felt that I was more and more sleepy in the morning before my morning coffee, but I was super alert at night. I was also always super tired on the weekends, and sometimes my heart would be beating really fast and I wasn't sure if it's palpitations or anxiety. I loved gaming, and I knew that all my friends would lose most of their games terribly without me, but I had to change my lifestyle. So I looked at my habits and found this weird pattern. There's some days where I would lie in bed and I can feel my heart racing and pounding to the point where I can hear my own heartbeat. Needless to say, on those days, I would have a very hard time falling asleep, tossing and turning late into the night. I always attributed this to stress or anxiety, or maybe that I had a really exhilarating game right before sleep. But then I noticed this crazy pattern. This happens almost every time I drank a bubble tea that day. And this is the first negative health issue related to caffeine: increased heart rate or irregular heart rate. The mechanism is fairly simple. Caffeine is a stimulant. It stimulates our central nervous system, increasing our heart rate. And it might not just increase the beats per minute. It could also increase the chance of the heart beating irregularly, something called atrial fibrillation. I couldn't confirm that I personally had atrial fibrillation because that diagnosis requires an ECG, but I could definitely feel my own palpitations. The second negative health thing that happened to me was obviously insomnia. But this didn't happen to me every day, so I was not suspicious of caffeine at first. However, when this made me more and more tired during the day and more awake at night, I started reflecting again. It does seem like whenever I have that extra cup of bubble tea, that's when I usually get the insomnia. And obviously, there was this dose-dependent effect of caffeine on my sleep quality. The one cup of coffee that I have in the morning has about 75 milligrams of caffeine. I typically have a latte with one shot of espresso. If I grab that extra bubble tea at lunch with my coworkers, and I usually get a large milk tea with pearls, that's 700 mils of milk tea with about 150 milligrams of caffeine. And then if I have another Coke Zero with dinner, that's another 34 milligrams of caffeine in a 375 ml can. Oh, by the way, I made this PDF that's a cheat sheet of all the caffeine amounts in popular drinks, and you can download it for free. I'll put the link down below. So 75 milligrams is what I thought I'd be getting in a day. But in reality, what I'm actually getting is a maximum of 259 milligrams of caffeine. And the majority of this is consumed towards the end of the day. And if you didn't know this, caffeine has a half-life of 5 hours. That means, after 5 hours, I would still have 50% of the caffeine left in my body. With this extremely suboptimal routine that I've developed, I didn't feel energetic, inspired, or motivated. I felt that every morning, I respond in the fountain with half HP and only enough mana to perform my everyday tasks. But I wasn't capable of making any big productive combos. But then when the evening comes, I wasn't able to truly rest. And that's definitely not what I wanted to do. I want to feel focused when I need to and be able to relax when I need to. And I wanted to do all of that without relying on a substance. So I decided to cut down. But I knew I couldn't quit cold turkey. There are studies to confirm there are caffeine withdrawal symptoms, with the most recognizable one being caffeine withdrawal headaches. I already get migraines on a regular basis, so I definitely don't want even more headaches. I had to find a way to cut down slowly, safely, and without rebound. And here are the three easy and scientific steps that I followed. And using my knowledge in pharmacology, I knew this would work. Step one was the easiest one. I kept my morning coffee, but cut out any other caffeinated beverages. And of course, that includes caffeinated soft drinks like my favorite Coke Zero. But I found out that Sprite Zero also has no sugar and no caffeine. So I drank that as an alternative. And then it was the bubble tea. This one was harder, but not impossible. Instead of not being able to visit any bubble tea store at all after I decided to quit, I would instead buy a fruity drink like a smoothie or a slushie. So with this step number one, I've effectively cut out any unsolicited caffeine, especially later during the day. And I limited my caffeine intake to just the 75 milligram of caffeine in my morning coffee. I kept this going for a good few weeks, and thankfully I didn't have any withdrawal headaches. And I started to feel more and more tired at bedtime, which is a good thing. That's exactly what I wanted to feel before I go to bed. Step two was the scariest for me, because now we're going to play around with that seemingly untouchable morning cup of coffee. I knew what I had to find, a coffee substitute that contained less caffeine, but gave me the similar wake-up effect that I needed. And then when it comes to the time where I cut it off completely, it would be a smoother transition. I had the confidence that as long as the science makes sense, this would work. Because this is just like my job when we try to adjust doses in patients. If we try to stop a drug, a lot of the times the drug can cause withdrawal symptoms. Like for example, a lot of antidepressants like SSRIs or SNRIs, opioids is a really big one, and a lot of sleep medications. We would first find a patient a similar drug that's a little bit weaker but has similar pharmacological effect. For example, if we want to taper someone off of fentanyl, which is a long-acting opioid patch that lasts for 72 hours, that drug just stays in the body for way too long for us to effectively cut that down. We would transition that patient to something like hydromorphone, which is a lot faster acting and easier to taper. And then we would work with the hydromorphone and slowly taper that patient off. For example, starting with one pill a day, and then we'll go down to half a tablet a day, and then half a tablet every other day, and then eventually stop. And after a lot of research, I think I found my coffee alternative, and that is green tea. And of course, I'm not the first person to come up with this comparison between coffee and tea. In fact, the very first person to conduct a coffee versus tea study was a Swedish king King Gustav III in the 18th century. There was this pair of murderers who also happened to be twin brothers, and they were sentenced to death. But instead of executing them in the normal way, the king sentenced them to life in prison. But one of the brothers had to drink 3 pots of coffee a day, and the other brother had to drink the same amount of tea a day. Cruel, I know. But jokes on the king, because he actually died first. Can you guess which of the brothers died first? It was the brother that drank the tea. And he died at age 83. There's actually no record of when the coffee drinking brother died, because all the doctors that were assigned by the king to monitor the study died before him. So what does this experiment tell us? Nothing. We can't confirm or deny that drinking coffee is better than drinking tea. But I just thought that was a funny story, so I wanted to share that with you. But modern scientists did do more studies to compare the effect of coffee versus the effect of tea. And as you can see in my cheat sheet, green tea has about 45 milligrams of caffeine per cup. But what it also has that coffee doesn't is a substance called l-theanine. L-theanine is a derivative of a substance called L-glutamic acid, which is a neurotransmitter in the brain. And it's been shown to do a lot of things for our mental state. It can increase the production of alpha waves, which promotes this thing called relaxed alertness. It has effects on serotonin and dopamine releases in our brain, and it can modulate our mood. But these are just how L-theanine work on the molecular level in the body. I obviously needed more than that. I wanted to see real human trials on how tea versus coffee can have effects on our energy, focus, and stress. And I was able to find studies that experimented on humans just like King Gustav did. And what I found was very promising. There are several studies that showed that green tea compared to placebo increased cognitive function and sleep quality. The test subjects were also followed for 12 months, which is a very good length of time for a smaller scale study. Another study showed that the test subjects were able to maintain functional focus following a mild acute stress after drinking green tea. And another study showed that green tea was able to combat blood pressure rise when the test subjects were under stress. So with decent confidence that L-theanine had good evidence, and the fact that each cup of green tea only had half the level of caffeine compared to coffee, I went for it and began the experiment on myself. And to be honest, I did struggle with it in the beginning, especially the first hour after drinking it in the morning. So that's usually between 9 to 10 a.m. and also after lunchtime, and that's about 2 to 3 p.m. But that all made sense though, because I used to drink a much larger amount of caffeine in the morning, which gave me that initial kick and made me hyper-focused. And after lunchtime, because I had already cut out all the extra caffeine throughout my diet in the day, with the green tea now, it didn't leave me as much caffeine in the body, so I would have the world's biggest food coma after lunch. So the initial couple of weeks was definitely tough. But the fact that I didn't really have any palpitations anymore, and that I was able to sleep a lot better at night, kept me going. And then slowly and slowly, my body got used to this new baseline, and I could feel my HP restoring. And this continued on just fine. Instead of a coffee drinker, I'm now a tea drinker. But I knew I had to go to the dreaded step 3 if I wanted to quit completely. And that is diet, exercise, and sleep. Which of course sounds the easiest and the cheesiest, but it's probably the hardest for any of us. I hate sounding preachy and be like, you need to take care of your body and just eat and sleep well, even though that's totally true. So I'm just going to give you one practical tip from each of these that worked for me. Diet. The most significant result I saw in terms of my energy level was when I limited my carbohydrate intake during lunchtime. So high carbohydrate and high fat content in a meal is a major contributor to food coma, or postprandial somnolence in medical terms. So I try to have a less carby lunch to save myself from the intolerable feeling of having to take a long afternoon nap. Exercise. I started going to the gym 3 months ago, and believe me, out of everything that I mentioned, this is probably the toughest change I have to make. Everyone knows that exercise is good for you, but in 2024, my New Year's resolution was to make this YouTube channel happen, and that was my top priority. Everything else I kind of brushed to the side, but about 3 months ago, I started just casually going to the gym, maybe about 2 to 3 times a week and about 40 minutes each time. The American Heart Association guideline is to do aerobic exercise 150 minutes per week and strength training 2 times a week. So I'm definitely not there yet, but I think this is a good start. And trust me, I hate exercising. I would rather just stay home and game all day. But honestly, I am starting to notice a difference in my energy and focus levels. I just feel generally stronger. Like if I have to carry groceries from my car to my house, I'm not as tired. And when I run for my train in the morning, I'm not as out of breath. And I just feel more energetic during the day. I actually usually go to the gym at night. It makes me pretty tired after, and I basically fall asleep right when my head hits my pillow. Which leads me to my last point, sleep. If you sleep more at night, you have more energy during the day. Simple as that. I know not everyone needs 8 hours of sleep, but I'm definitely someone that does. And when I was on a lot of caffeine and slept really late, I definitely did not get 8 hours every day. But by doing everything else that I've talked about in this video, I'm now getting consistently 8 hours of sleep every day, and that really improved my energy and focus levels. It's been a full year, and I honestly can't remember when's the last time I drank a cup of coffee. I bought this huge box of Nespresso pods from Costco before I decided to quit, and there's still so much left in the box. So on a typical workday, I go to work for 8 hours. Plus, it takes me about 40 minutes each way to get there and come back home. I come home for dinner, and after that, I spend about 1 to 2 hours on my YouTube scripts. Then I wind down by either playing video games, maybe not the best way to wind down, playing the piano, or go to the gym. And then I go to sleep. And on the weekends, I usually film or edit videos. And at no point in time throughout my day, I need to have a scheduled cup of coffee or tea. The only time now that I drink caffeinated beverage is when I feel like it. So I've essentially terminated my need for caffeine to give me energy or productivity. Do you make any New Year's resolutions? If you do, leave them down below. Or are you someone that don't believe in them and think that you won't stick to them anyway? Let me know, I'm super curious to find out. Thanks for watching. If you like this type of videos from me, definitely let me know in the comments. I know it's different from my usual content on this channel, so I would love to hear your feedback. Please give this video a thumbs up and subscribe for more contents like this. I'll see you in the next one. Bye!